Hey, good morning, everyone. A little bit cold this morning, but we all seem to have made it all right. I've actually got a Bible verse for you this morning. In Genesis chapter 1, we go from verse 26 and 27. Then God said, "Let us make man in our image, in our likeness, and let them rule over the fish of the sea and the birds of the air, over the livestock, over all the earth, and over all the creatures that move along the ground." So God created man in his own image. In the image of God, he created him. Male and female, he created them.
Yes, thank you, Heavenly Father, that you did create us in your image. Lord, thank you that you created us male and female. Lord, we thank you for today. We thank you for this new day that we can worship you. And Lord, we pray your spirit would be with us and that he would help lift our praises to you. In Jesus' name, amen.
Thank you. not just me up here at the front this morning. There's a team that is joining me as we celebrate prayer and self-denial. So let me ask Leslie to come up now. She's got an intro for us for this week.
Morning. For 137 years, we have had a relationship with the Bengali people. We have been deeply involved in church planting and discipleship, education, humanitarian aid work, and medical work. The Bengali people make up the largest unreached people group in the world, with less than 1% being Christian. The Bengali people are among the very poorest in the world. Bengali Christians are among the most persecuted groups in the world. God has called different people with different skills throughout the years. Sometimes we can get the idea that only a certain type of person is wanted, but God calls everyone.
Ruth, can I invite you up to read the scripture for us this morning, please?
Good morning. Reading from Matthew 9, 37 to 38. Jesus said to his disciples, "The harvest is plentiful, but the workers are few. Ask the Lord of the harvest, therefore, to send out workers into his harvest field."
Okay, so this week we're focusing on week two of prayer and self-denial. And the theme is made in God's image, if you didn't guess that already. So God has hand-carved each person and each place in beautiful uniqueness, with particularities, features, and distinctions that are specific. Where has God uniquely created you to be? I think this is a challenging question for us as people who are created in the image of God. What is our role to be in mission? So let's start then with what it means to be created in the image of God. Grudem writes that of all the creatures God made, only one creature, man, is said to be made in the image of God. What does that mean? Being created in the image of God means that man is like God and represents God. The fact that man is in the image of God means that man is like God in the following ways. Humankind has intellectual ability and can think and reason. Animals act on instinct, but mankind has the ability to discern the way ahead and make decisions. Humankind has the ability to be morally pure, knowing the difference between right and wrong. Animals don't necessarily know the difference between right and wrong. Man has a nature that is not only physical, but spirit. Man has been given authority to rule over creation. These are some of the outworkings of what being made in God's image is all about. Now let's be clear, while we are like God, we are clearly not Him. We can be corrupted, as we saw with the fall and the story of Adam and Eve. God is incorruptible. We can be like God, but we are not God. So this begs the question then, if we are made in His likeness, are we still that way after the fall? Well, the answer is that we have not lost the ability to be image bearers, but when sin entered the world, that image was distorted. We still know how to think and to reason and how to act in a moral way, but we often don't do it. Our nature has been corrupted by sin. But this is not the end for us, because there is one person who knew what it meant to be human and represent God in all the appropriate ways. Jesus, through His life, death, and resurrection, can show us what it means to be true image bearers of God. He is our example. Let's turn to 1 Peter 1, 22 to 23, if you have your scriptures with you. I'll just read this verse for us. It says, "Now that you have been purified yourselves by obeying the truth so that you have sincere love for each other, Love one another deeply from the heart. For you have been born again, not of perishable seed, but of imperishable, through the living and enduring word of God. Okay, now we know what it means to be image bearers of God, made in the likeness of Christ. How can we then apply this to mission, to the people and places that God is calling us to share the gospel with? Hopefully, this week you've been thinking about someone. Have you thought about who you can share the gospel with? Have you got a name? Let's see those hands. Not yet? Yeah? Good. Awesome. Right. So now we're going to take being image bearers of Christ and turn that into mission. What does that look like? Last week we read a scripture that said, "Then the 11 disciples went to Galilee, to the mountain where Jesus had told them to go. And when they saw him, they worshipped him, but some doubted. Then Jesus came to them and said, 'All authority in heaven and on earth has been given to me. Therefore go and make disciples of all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit, and teaching them to obey everything I have commanded you. And surely I am with you always, to the very end of the age.'" Last week we delved into that portion of scripture, but there was one fact that we left out. I wonder if you noticed that it said 11 disciples. Right, so they were a man down over there. Someone didn't rise to the challenge, we all know who. And in fact, he made the task much harder. So how do we do mission in the context where there is so much to do and so few to accomplish it, and where God is calling us to the harvest? I love the story where Jesus sent out the 72 disciples. So not the 12, there were 72. I'll read to you what it says. "After this, the Lord appointed 72 others and sent them two by two ahead of him to every town and place where he was about to go. He told them, 'The harvest is plentiful, but the workers are few. Ask the Lord of the harvest, therefore, to send out workers into his harvest field. Go, I am sending you out like lambs amongst wolves. Do not take a purse or bag or sandals, and do not greet anyone on the road. When you enter a house, first say, "Peace to this house." If someone who promotes peace is there, your peace will rest on them. If not, it will return to you. Stay there, eating and drinking whatever they give you, for the workers deserve his wages. Do not move around from house to house. When you enter a town and are welcomed, eat what is offered to you. Heal the sick who are there, and tell them the kingdom of God has come near to you. But when you enter a town and are not welcomed, go into the streets and say, 'Even the dust of your town we wipe from our feet as a warning to you.' Yet be sure of this, the kingdom of God has come near. I tell you, it will be more bearable on that day for Sodom than for that town. Woe to you, Chorazin, woe to you, Bethsaida, for if the miracles that were performed in you were performed in Tyre and Sidon, they would have repented long ago, sitting in sackcloth and ashes. But it will be more bearable for Tyre and Sidon at the judgment than for you. And you, Capernaum, will you be lifted to the heavens? No, you will go down to Hades. Whoever listens to you listens to me. Whoever rejects you rejects me. But whoever rejects me rejects him who sent me." The 72 returned with joy and said, "Lord, even the demons submit to us in your name." And he replied, "I saw Satan falling like lightning from heaven. I have given you authority to trample on snakes and scorpions and to overcome all the powers of the enemy. Nothing will harm you. However, do not rejoice that the spirits submit to you, but rejoice that your names are written in heaven." And at that time, Jesus, full of joy through the Holy Spirit, said, "I praise you, Father, Lord of heaven and earth, because you have hidden these things from the wise and learned and revealed them to little children. Yes, Father, for this is what you were pleased to do. All things have been committed to me by my Father. No one knows who the Son is except the Father, and no one knows who the Father is except the Son, and to those whom the Son chooses to reveal him. Then he turned to the disciples and said privately, Blessed are the eyes that see what you see. For I tell you that many prophets and kings wanted to see what you see, but did not see it, and to hear what you hear, but did not hear it. It's an amazing portion of scripture, right? What can we learn from this in regards to us partaking in mission? Well, the first thing I think, and it's a wonderful thing, is that we don't have to do mission alone. Praise the Lord. We can partner with each other in the mission. Two is better than one, said Jesus. We use those things that God has given us as image bearers as we go out and do mission. We must be wise. Sadly, not everyone is ready for the good news. And so we need to prioritize our time on the ones who are keen and willing. We give everyone a chance, but if they don't express interest, we move on to someone else. One of the signs we need to move on is a lack of hospitality or willingness to see our worth. Did you notice that when Jesus was talking to the disciples? So mission should be welcomed, and missionaries should be welcomed. That's how we know that we can do mission in that place. If we are not welcomed, then it's time to move on. The amazing thing also in the scripture, which I spoke a bit about yesterday, because I introduced everyone at the reflection event to the idea of kingdom lenses, right? As I have shown you guys in the past many times. But do you notice how it says the kingdom of heaven has come near, right? We so forget that in this day and age. We forget that the kingdom of God surrounds us all the time. We go out in its power. We live in its strength. And so we should pray for the sick, as Jesus said in the scripture. We should pray for those troubled by dark forces. And believe me, they are on the rise today. I think many people, are struggling under that. And we have to know that the power of heaven is truly behind us, that miracles will happen when we go out in his name, because the kingdom of heaven has come near. It's interesting that the scripture also talks about the wages for those that undertake mission. And so as the church, we are duty bound, I believe, to support our brothers and sisters who go to places that we cannot. We must make sure that they have the resources they need, that their physical needs are met. Because let's face it, mission can also be dangerous. When we go out and we share the gospel, there is a risk attached to that in today's society. What if our message is not received? How will we deal with the discomfort of that? Can we live with the fallout, the lost relationships? Jesus will always be there to back us up. I think that's why something like prayer and self-denial is so important. It's an exercise for us as well to prepare for mission. Through supporting our missionaries overseas, we learn how best to serve God in his calling to us, with our people and our place. Jesus encouraged his disciples at that time. He said, while mission likely will involve rejection, in this instance, remember that it's the rejection of me, really, that's at stake here. It's ultimately God who is being rejected. Isaiah 53:3 says that Jesus was despised and rejected by mankind, a man of suffering and familiar with pain, like one whom people hid their faces. He was despised and he was held in low esteem. And yet he still went out and fulfilled his mission that God had given him for the world. As his people, we need to learn to be resilient, to take the knocks, because he is so worth it. And it is worth it to do mission, because by now you're wondering, is it really so? It sounds so hard, God. But let me tell you, there's no greater feeling than when the Spirit of God works through you to bring about gospel transformation. We read about the disciples coming back, rejoicing and amazed at all the things they were able to accomplish through Jesus. And these were ordinary folk, like you and me. They weren't trained like most missionaries are today. God can make use of you in ways you couldn't possibly imagine, if only you give him a chance to use you. He is calling you right now. Will you go? Lastly, when we see success in mission, we see especially that we must keep Christ in mind. Remember last week I said that if we do that, if we keep our eyes focused on Jesus, we'll keep our motivation on the straight and narrow. And Jesus warned the disciples of this. In verse 18, he said, I saw Satan falling from lightning, like lightning from heaven. I have given you authority to trample on snakes and scorpions and to overcome all the power of the enemy. Nothing will harm you. However, do not rejoice that the spirits submit to you, but rejoice that your names are written in heaven. Follow this path and answer God's call to participate in mission, and you will find joy, and better yet, you will bring him joy. I love this portion where it says, at that time, Jesus, full of the joy through the Holy Spirit, said, I praise you, Father, Lord of heaven and earth, because you have hidden these things from the wise and the learned and revealed them to little children. Yes, Father, for this is what you were pleased to do. And how wonderful a privilege it is to participate in God's mission. Jesus turned to his disciples and said, blessed are the eyes that see what you see. For I tell you that many prophets and kings wanted to see what you see, but they did not, and to hear what you hear, but they did not hear. I think it is something that we should all aspire to, this life of mission. This is what is the main purpose of living a Christian life, honoring God, obeying his commands, and then sharing the blessing of a faith life with others. And we have been equipped by him. Believe it or not, you have been equipped by him, hand-carved in his image to do the works that he does in the people and places that God has called you to. Barbara, will you come and pray for us, please? Thank you.
Let us pray. God of all, born into poverty in an occupied land, who was displaced and had to flee, who found community alongside those who were oppressed and marginalized, and who died among thieves. Today, we pray for your people around the world. We pray for those who have been displaced and who do not have a place to call home, for those who live in fear of claiming you by name, and for those who do not yet know you by name. And we pray, may you transform us to be more like you. You called your neighbor friend. You chose humility so the kingdom could speak through you. And your obedience, even to the point of death, gave us life. We long for more to know the name of Christ and for our world to be transformed. Teach us to see that as we walk with others, you are there. Teach us to welcome not only the stranger, but the gifts they bring, to see your fingerprints on each one of us. In your name we pray. Amen.
if the kingdom of God has come near and you are equipped to go out and do mission, I want to challenge you this week to connect with that person that God has put on your heart. I'll be your second, right? So if anything comes up in conversation and you need some advice, come and get in touch with me. Tell me when you're meeting that person so that I can pray for them as well and back you up. All you need to do is make friends, right? Sit and have a coffee, have a chat, and wait for your moment. And it will come up where you get to share how good God has been for you and how he loves them. And then tell them, all right? Be brave and do it. You can all do it. All right. Let's pray and then we can go and have a cup of tea and coffee. Lord God, we accept your mission. We accept your calling on our lives. You have handcrafted us, each one of us, with the skills we need to meet the people that you have placed in our lives. So Lord, may we bring your kingdom near to those around us, those that you have put on our heart to share the gospel with. Empower our meetings with those people, Lord. May these hearts be open. May peace rest in those houses, Lord. May our mission be welcomed. We long to bring you joy, Lord, as we welcome more into your kingdom, because that's what it's all about. We praise and honor you, Lord, and we thank you for all that you have done for us, for your mission to us, Lord, and we long to return that goodwill. In Jesus' name, we pray a blessing on everyone here this morning and on our time of fellowship out there this morning. We praise you, Heavenly Father. Thank you. What a great, great God you are. Amen.